마리노스 앳큐 가든스. 마리노스 앳큐 가든스. 프레퍼스. The Marinos Gallery has been one of the greatest treasures of Kew since it first opened in 1882, and it has continued to delight the often unsuspecting visitors who have made their way to this Victorian building in a less-known area of the gardens near the Temperate House. 832 close-packed botanical paintings, nearly all painted in the wild from many countries of the world, are displayed in a gallery designed under Miss North's supervision. The architecture is curious and includes pictures of Greek temple design, hand-painted surround to the doors, and the lower part of the walls clad in 246 different types of wood, which the artist collected during her travels. But one hardly noticed the architecture. The sheer impact of the richly colored oil paintings, frequently exacted under conditions of extreme discomfort and in hazardous places, overwhelmed the viewer and always prompt the question, who was this extraordinary woman? The tale of her life and trouble has been told in a two-volume autobiography, Recollection of a Happy Life, and the third volume, Further Recollection of a Happy Life, was put together after Miss North's death by her sister, Catherine Sidmon. These books are rare and require concentrated reading, as they have only a few black and white photographs and maps to enliven the text. The publication in 1980 by Webb and Bow with the Royal Botanic Gardens, Kew, of A Vision of Eden, which contains a shortened and edited version of Recollections and beautiful reproduction of many of her paintings, first brought Marinos to the attention of a wider public. 1990 is the centenary of the death of his outstanding Victorian lady, the traveler, and once again, Webb and Bower, together with Kew, has produced a collection of Marinos's finest paintings, many of which have never previously been published. They ask Laura Ponsonby, the great authority on her life and work, to write a concise biography, drawing on unpublished material in the archives of at Kew and elsewhere. Miss Pansobi has also contributed detailed caption to the painting, which highlight the importance of the plant and the scenes depicted, many of which are now under threat from the archives of mankind, from the activities of mankind, and some of which have gone forever. I welcome this beautiful book and I'm sure that 100 years after her death, it will elevate Marinos to her rightful position among the great plant explorers of the Victorian age. Professor G.T. France, Director, Royal Botanic Gardens, Kew. Introduction. Strawberry Station is not perhaps a place where many people sit and write letters, but it was there on 11 August 1879 that Marinos took off her pen to write to Sir Joseph Hooker, the director of the Royal Botanic Gardens, Kew, to inquire whether he would accept her painting as a gift to Kew. Marinos had missed her train and characteristically, not wishing to be idle even for an hour or two, wrote her letter, putting forward an idea which she had been brooding over for some time. She had in fact been suggested after exhibition in Conduit Street earlier that year that the painting should find their ultimate home at Kew. In a letter to Sir Joseph, Marie Narromi proposed to build a gallery to house the picture. He should have a garden house and studio attached, but wanted the visitor to be provided tea or coffee and biscuit, nothing else, at a fair price. Sir Joseph acquiesced in all but the fresh refreshment, which at that time were not allowed in the gardens, and point out in any case the impossibility of keeping the great British family in order, especially on a bank holiday when there might be 77,000 people all at once. Marinos asked a friend, James Ferguson, the architectural historian and the author of History of Architecture, to design the building, and herself chose the site, which was to be well away from the main gate and all the fashionable promenaders. It would be found only by those who really cared for plant and had taken the trouble to make their way through all the greenhouses. They would be rewarded with a portrait of many of the plants they had just seen pictured in their native habitat, and would have a place to rest and shelter from the element if needed. Even today, the gallery is found by comparatively few visitors. They weary and thirsty, having got thus far, anticed by the promise of refreshment now available nearby, and barely give the North Gallery a second glance. Those who unwittingly do decide to ascend the step are totally unprepared for the sight which meet their eye, and their look of utter astonishment and bewilderment is worth beholding. Before them and around them are tier upon tier of brightly colored paintings of plants, landscapes, birds, animals, and insects. Okay.